It is little wonder that a game so close to our hearts has provided so many nurturing memories. Moments of joy that often focus on a select few whose feats are so legendary that their names are etched on our Canadian consciousness forever.
The boards. Bob Bond lets it drive. It goes.
Scores!
Bob Bond, let it go.
He scores! McDonald. Dyke centered it. And that scores! Andy McDonald. Anderson right in. Scores! What a goal. Looking for his first goal of the series. Scores! Gretzky in on goal.
And the Montreal Canadiens win the Stanley Cup.
When the Hockey News listed the top 50 players of all time, five great Canadians stood on top. Their moments will stand forever.
Get ready for the star of the show. In center ice, Rocket Richard. Across the blue line. Most players might pass the Rocket shoot. The game is over.
Rocket, what can you say? He was sent down by the man up above just to show us how to score goals.
In the NHL's first season, Joe Malone scored 44 goals, a mark that stood for 27 years. In February of 1945, the Rocket scored his 45th of the season to pass Malone, with eight games left to play. The impossible 50 was reachable. The Rocket's moment was at hand.
The Montreal Canadiens set off a three-goal scoring burst late in the final period to gain their 10th straight win over the Boston Bruins 4-2 in the windup of the regular National Hockey League season. Just when the Bruins appeared to have their first win of the season over the Canadiens, Richard snatched it from them by whacking in Elmer Locke's pass-out to boost his 1944-45 total to an even half-hundred goals. The Gazette, Montreal.
When Maurice Richard scored in the Montreal Forum, the cheer was a decibel or so, just a little bit more than for. I mean, the many great players, Elmer Locke could score a game-winning goal with a minute to go, and everybody would be, you know, the place would be bedlam. But when the Rocket scored, somehow to me, I'll never forget that. It's always just, it seemed to be just a touch more because he was the Rocket.
From the time he was selected first in the draft of 84, Mario Lemieux was tested. His battles with back injuries and then Hodgkin's disease measured his heart. His six scoring titles and three Hart trophies measured his enormous talent. But the true measure of any player is winning it all. In the summer of 1990, Mario had back surgery and missed the first 50 games of the season. He returned to lead the Pens on a perfect playoff run.
What a play by Mario Lemieux. Coming up. Look at Lemieux.
Severe pain followed Mario into the finals against Minnesota. Despite sitting out for Game 3, he delivered one of the greatest playoff performances ever. Lemieux notched 44 playoff points, four on the night the Penguins won their first Stanley Cup.
The moment they've all been waiting for.
In those 2 years when Pittsburgh won their cups in 91 and 92, he raised the individual, the level of the individual game to maybe as high a peak as I've ever seen anybody. And he's a legend and deservedly so.
The Pittsburgh Penguins, two in a row.
In 1971, after a 25-year career, Gordie Howe retired from the Red Wings as the game's all-time leading scorer. He led the league in points and was named MVP six times. Number 9 played in 22 All-Star games, won 4 Stanley Cups, and was immediately inducted into the Hall of Fame. Most players would have been content, but after 2 years of retirement, Mr. Hockey joined his sons, Mark and Marty, with the Houston Aeros of the fledgling WHA.
You know, I think in some ways it may be too bad that the longevity of his career is what he's best remembered for. And so some of these things that he did when he was at his so-called peak, we tend to forget now. But that's the way it is. He became Mr. Hockey in some ways because he outlasted all the other claimants to the title.
I always tell people he was so kind to me. And then the first time I'm playing against him, I was 17 years old. Second shift of the game, I went down the ice and I lifted up a stick and I started skating the other way. All of a sudden, I got a two-hander over my thumb and I just went, oh, and cracked my thumb. And I kind of went like this, and Gordy skated by me and said, "Don't ever embarrass me on the ice." And he was serious.
4 seasons later, Gordy and the boys moved north. And when the Hartford Whalers made their NHL debut, 51-year-old Howe played all 80 regular season games and helped earn the team a berth in the playoffs. In February 1980, 33 years after his rookie season, Gordy was selected to play in his 23rd and final All-Star game back in Detroit.
And from the Hartford Whalers, representing all of hockey with great distinction for 5 decades, number 9.
It was a triumphant moment as Detroit paid homage to the legend. Sharing the ice with the likes of Lafleur, Bossy, Dion, and a rookie named Gretzky, Howe assists on the Wales Conference's final goal in a 6-3 victory. A 22-year-old defenseman from Parry Sound, Ontario, is leading a hockey revolution, changing the way the game is played.
Bobby Orr controls in the Boston zone as Nestor couldn't. Bobby Orr legs it back up through center ice. Cuts deep, goes behind the net. Oh, shot!
In his rookie season, the Bruins were worst in the league. In 4 years, he took them to a first-place tie with Chicago. By the time they met in the semifinals, the Hawks were overmatched as the big bad Bruins took 4 straight. In the finals, they faced Scotty Bowman's St. Louis Blues. After 3 convincing defeats, the Blues make a stand, and Game 4 goes to overtime in a sweaty night at the Boston Garden. Steam rises from the ice. 40 seconds into overtime, Robert Gordon Orr, number 4, has his greatest moment as a Bruin.
It was a famous goal for me for one reason. It was our first Stanley Cup. You know, I always thought when you decide to become a hockey player, your ultimate goal should be win the Stanley Cup. When that goal went in, that's all I thought of. I was at the other end, and I said, "We won the Stanley Cup."
Bobby Orr, the 22-year-old sensation, scores after 40 seconds of overtime, and the Bruins win.
If you look at the photo, as he's flying through the air, he knows he's scored because he's already almost like raising his hands, although he's lateral to the ice.
I always knew that if I could get Wayne's cheeks to flush, he had a certain blush in his face. And when I got his face into that blush, I knew that there was no stopping him. He never got tired. He could do what he wanted on the ice. And I used to watch for that flush, that indication. And that's when I knew that he was on a whole different level than everybody else.
He scores!
knock loose. Here he is, Gretzky. He fakes, spins, and a backhand shot.
You know, there was nights when he could have scored 9 or 10 points. And he would just back off because he wouldn't want to embarrass the team. And I used to keep playing him because I knew that the opportunity was there for him to do something that nobody else could do.
Away pass to Gretzky. Greg Lubbe trying to catch him. Can't. Gretzky scores! His fifth of the night.
I had an incredible fear that I was going to get to 47 or 48 and not get 50 and 50. So that's kind of what drove me.
It was a game that I wasn't at. I was sitting at home watching on television, and he was 5 goals away. And I'm sort of there lounging in jeans and just watching. There's goal number one, goal number two. And I'm saying, I'm going to have to get to the hockey game. So goal number three goes in. I'm saying, like, I'm on my way. I'm driving toward Northlands. Number four, while I'm in the car on the radio. I walked in the back door of Northlands Coliseum as Gretzky is coming down the ice. Open net against Philadelphia.
Gretzky, will he shoot? He does. He scores! Wayne Gretzky's 50th goal in 39 games. 5 goals tonight. They are going wild.
It's a wonderful memory because I was there behind the net. Bird's eye view.
So when the 50th went in, I was probably more shocked than anybody in Canada. Because I didn't expect it. I told my dad, don't come, that's not going to happen. Wait a couple games.
Gretzky,